I think I'll tell them how he saved me. I think I'll let them know. I think I'll tell them how his grace to others he will show. I think I'll tell them what a friend to me this man has been. I think I'll tell them about Jesus. Then I think I'll tell them again. Tell them again, tell them again. I'm gonna tell everybody about my friend. Tell them again, tell them again. I think I'll tell them over again.
I'll tell them that the price was paid for you and me.
I think I'll tell them how he turned my life around and there.
I think I'll tell them about Jesus. Then I think I'll tell them again.
Tell them again, tell them again. I'm gonna tell everybody about the friend. Tell them again, tell them again. I think I'll tell them over again.
I'm gonna tell them about Jesus. I'm gonna tell them about Jesus Christ. Gonna tell them about Jesus. I'm gonna tell them about Jesus Christ.
Tell
Here's another episode of Steve's on the Mic with friends telling their stories about how Jesus changed their lives. This episode features two longtime friends, Alan and Lisa Holzbog. My friendship with Alan goes all the way back to a first grade classroom in English, Indiana. I met Lisa in junior high school. The three of us graduated together from Crawford County High School in 1981. After high school, we parted ways to pursue three totally different paths. Although Alan and Lisa were for a time high school sweethearts, they both went separate ways to start families of their own in different communities. Some 30 years later, Lisa was a widow and Alan was divorced, and they found each other and decided to get married. Shortly after their marriage, they both committed their lives to Jesus and found new meaning and purpose in life. Alan walked away from a dysfunctional past, and now they continue to enjoy their love for Jesus together, and Alan is now a worship minister in their local church. They have a great story to tell, so let's hear more from them. Here's a portion of my recent conversation with Alan and Lisa Holzbog.
On the day that Lisa buried her husband, I met a friend of mine, and he asked me if I knew Lisa Stevenson, and I was kind of like you. I said, no, I don't know Lisa Stevenson. And he said, yeah, you know her. And he mentioned her maiden name, and I said, oh, yeah, I remember her. Well, he told me where he'd been that day, and he'd actually been to the funeral. And he said, if you want, give me your number and I'll give it to her. Well, I mean, I didn't know how to react to that because the poor woman just had buried her husband that day. So, but I did. I gave it to her and or gave it to him. And I guess a couple of months had gone by, and she was having a really rough time and opened up a carton, and that number fell out. Well, it was Valentine's Day. It was around 10 o'clock at night, and I was asleep on my couch. So, and she called, and we had a great conversation. We talked for about 2 hours, probably, on the phone that night. And, we decided to get together, and she needed somebody to lean on. And of course, I was going through a pretty rough patch there. And she just needed to have some fun. So we got together, and we went out a few times, and we really enjoyed each other's company. I know I enjoyed her company. So, as time went on, it seemed we were getting a little bit more serious, and we, we moved in together, and we lived in two or three different places. And then we bought a modular home and put it on some property I have in English. And we lived there for several years. And then I think we were together 2 years before we got married. And we married in 2010. Mm-hmm. 2010. So we're coming up on 14 years of married bliss here.
Wow. And
so...
It's kind of neat, Steve, when you marry your best friend.
So, yeah, that was a neat story. You two had dated for a while in high school, not a real long time, but then went your different directions. So let me fast forward. You two get together and marry, and I catch wind of that story on Facebook. And Sharon, do you remember me telling you that story about so happy for Alan and Lisa? I just thought it was a cool story. So I drove down. We were living in Elkhart, and I drove down to Crawford County to work the elementary basketball tourney. Lisa Smith was the principal at Patoka School, and she invited me in. So I'm set up to work the basketball game, and I think Lisa must have called Alan's mother and father and said, Steve's coming to work our tourney, and you guys make sure he feels like he belongs here. because Marilyn got there early, and she set up a seat right next to where I had my booth set up, and we struck up a conversation. And I asked, how's Alan and Lisa? And told her, I said, I'm so excited. That's such a great story. And your mom just started bubbling over with joy. She said, oh, Steve, they're so happy. And she said, you probably haven't heard, but a couple of weeks ago, they went to church at Tunnel Hill and recommitted their lives to Jesus. And they've been going to church there ever since. And then your dad came in. And your dad... I'll never forget the way your folks treated me. I mean, they made me feel like that I belonged there
Amen.
And made me feel at home. And, but anyhow, then your brother Mike comes up and it's kind of more the same. Hey, I didn't know you're going to be here working. And yeah, I just found out Alan committed his life to Jesus and can't wait to talk to him. Hadn't talked to you probably since that last day of high school in 1981.
That's very possible.
If at all. But your mom took my phone number and Mike took my phone number and he gave me your number. And when I left the gym that night, now it had been 40 plus years since I even talked to you. Now, neither one of us had a cell phone in 1981, if I remember correctly.
No.
So when I left the gym that night, I pulled out Patoka School on Highway 64 and punched up your number. And I'm thinking, he's going to see South Bend, Indiana on his screen. He probably doesn't, there's no way he's even going to take the call. But I think the phone rang once, and without hesitation, I hear, hello, Steve. You remember that phone conversation, Alan?
I do. I remember the call now that you mention it. Yes.
But we talked from Patoka School most of the way my drive back to Corydon. I was staying in Corydon. Yeah. And it's one of those conversations, Alan, that is the purpose of this episode. It's one of those conversations I've had with people when they tell me about how Jesus changed their life, and I walk away thinking, that's a story worth telling. And I've right. told your story. I've shared it. I've talked about my friend Alan who met Jesus and walked away from a dysfunctional past. And you told me about your problem with alcohol. And those stories are so powerful that I decided I want to help people to tell those stories. But you told me, let's revisit that conversation a little bit about your lifestyle and how that so much of your life revolved around. You said earlier you tried to drink Anheuser-Busch out of business, but they kept brewing it faster than you could drink it.
Yeah, and you know, it I was a mess. I mean, I had been diagnosed a couple of years prior to that. That was probably around 2013, and the doctors told me that I had early stages of cirrhosis. And you know, most people with any sense would give it up at that point, because that, you know, you can heal, your liver can heal if you don't mistreat it anymore. Well, for some reason, I tended to just drink more. And I mentioned just how much I drank, and it was terrible. And, you know, the things that I'd done in late 2015, and I was working, and I'd go to work every morning just hungover and feeling terrible. And the only thing I could think of was getting off work so I could have another drink and try to get to feeling a little better. Well, other things was going on too. And I just had made a mess of my life, and I was making a mess of my marriage. And Lisa had taken all she could. So she goes, she should have left me, and I wouldn't have blamed her if she did. And I'm still amazed that I still call her my wife, because she had every right to just up and leave me. But she loved me so much that she wanted to save our marriage. And she got up on a Sunday morning, not knowing where she was going, but she went to church. She drove around, passed a little church, turned around, went back, and visited that church that day. And when she had left that morning, I wasn't sure she'd be back. But when she came back and told me where she had been, I don't know, something happened at that point. Now, I didn't stop drinking at that point. I just kept on drinking. So the next Sunday morning, the following Sunday morning, she gets up and was going to return to that church. Well, I had already been up, which was my routine. I'd been up since about 5 a.m. And by the time she got up, I'd already consumed 6 beers. And that's no kidding. So I made it to the bathroom and got myself cleaned up and walked out with some sort of dress clothes on. And she said, well, where are you going? And I said, well, I'm going with you. So when I walked into the church that morning, I was half in the box already. I had already consumed 6 beers, like I said. And for some reason, we were treated like I expect it's going to be when we get to heaven. Everybody there was just loving on us. Beyond my wildest imagination. I figured when they saw me walk in, it would have been whispers in the corner and, you know, just dirty looks, but that was not the case. They loved me, loved us, like I've never seen.
Let me just interject a little bit, Alan. When you were going through that, probably 6 or 8 years prior to that, I'd had a conversation or two with both your brothers, both Mike and Charlie, how Alan's doing. And man, that you could tell they loved you, but you could tell they were hurting for you.
Right.
At one point, I think Mike said, well, he's working now. He is still in the union and he is still working, but man, he's really struggling.
Yeah.
And I think maybe Charlie told me the same thing, and I didn't realize how serious that it was, but they expressed their love and concern for you. And were probably praying for you. You know, your mom and dad were.
All right.
But let's go back to that Sunday morning.
Okay. I didn't know it at the time, but I knew the pastor from our youth. We used to hang around each other a little bit, and we partied together.
He was a pretty heavy drinker himself.
Yes, and he gave his life to the Lord in 1999. And I would have never dreamed it. I mean, because I remember him from our youth, and just unbelievable transformation. And I think it was like, I've got to see this for myself.
Right.
And so he told me when he saw me walk in that day that the Holy Spirit came over him and he changed his message right while they were singing the hymn songs to get the service going. And the Holy Spirit told him to change his message. And so he preached a message out of John chapter 4, just off the cuff. He just opened the book up to John 4 and he started in. And for those that are listening that wouldn't know what John 4 is, it's the story of the woman at the well.
Yeah.
Well, it might be hard to imagine how somebody that was nothing more than a drunk at that point in his life could be saved by a message from the woman at the well. But when the pastor got to the 29th verse and he said, she returned to the town and she said, come see a man who told me all things that I've ever done. And that's when I realized that I wasn't hiding from nobody. I was a recluse. I mean, I just hid away in my house and was drinking myself to death. But I wasn't hiding from God. He knew everything that was going on inside me, my heart, my mind, all the ugly, and I saw his love that day. Just the way the pastor read the message or read the scripture and how he accepted the woman for what she was in all her sin, been married 5 times, and the man she's with, she's not even married to. And he showed nothing but compassion and love for her. Well, when he read the 29th verse, I could not wait. I mean, it was time. I was ready to jump over the pews and get to the altar because the Lord had already said, "This, you're mine. I've called you by name. You're mine."
Amen.
So, the most amazing thing that happened out of that, and it was an immediate transformation, Steve. I got up from the altar that day after I had just reached or called out to God, help me. I got up from the altar that day and I was sober, man. I was sober. immediately. People have a hard time believing that, but I was sober and I was done. There was no more alcohol. I never once went through withdrawals, and trust me, I've been drinking for 30 plus years, but I never went through withdrawals. Some friends of ours that are in the medical field said, you need to get him to a doctor, let him get some kind of medication, because coming down from the alcohol, the way he's doing it, it'll kill him.
Yeah. It's dangerous, yeah.
It was unbelievable. I never once had any kind of tremors or any withdrawals. It was just done. The Lord had just was delivered me from alcoholism.
No doctor, no medicine.
No doctor, no medicine, nothing. I mean, it was done at that very moment. And, you know, there was no looking back. So.
That was in 2015.
That was in 2015. And I believe it was late October. There's a little discrepancy there. It could have been the first Sunday of November, but I think it was the last Sunday of October. I'm not 100% sure.
So this is... This is pretty close to the conversation we had while I'm driving from Patoka School back to Cordon, and you're telling me this story. And when you went home, you still had beer in your house.
Yeah,
I did. I did, and I took it. It was a partial 30 pack, of course, and I took it and gave it to somebody and said, "Here it is. You can drink it or you can pour it out. I don't care what you're done with, do with it. I'm done with it." So that was the end of it. And I can't tell you how much the Lord has just worked on me and sanctified me daily since that time, and showing me the way to extend grace because of the grace that I've been extended. You know, some of the people that I was hanging with, they just, 6 weeks and he'll be back with us. But Steve, it never happened. It was done.
Wow.
I was delivered.
That's a miracle.
And they don't come over anymore.
No, and I don't see those people anymore.
Yeah, right.
It's amazing. How you, your relationships, I don't know that I can call them a friendship because it was probably nothing more than a relationship tied to the darkness and the mess that I was in. And after I was no longer in that darkness, those relationships kind of melted away. And
we're grateful.
Even as much as I've tried to, like Lisa said, we've prayed for them. We've, there's some of them that we've invited to come and join us at church, to not preach to them, but just love on them and tell them that there's something better, bigger than we can even imagine. And that was the whole thing. The pride that I had felt all those years telling everybody there's nothing wrong with me. I was shown that it was nothing more than arrogance. And I felt so much shame that Sunday morning in 2015 when the pastor read John 4:29. Like I said, I wasn't hiding it from nobody or from God. He knew it all. So I knew at that point there was no longer any reason to hide because he had reached out and touched me, so to speak, and showed me that there is a better way. There's a good life while we're here on this earth. But even greater than that is the promise that he gives us of our eternity. Spent with him.
So from there, we had that conversation, and a few months later, that was in late fall of the year, and I think maybe it was the following summer, just a few months later, my son and I go down to the Faith Rocks event.
Yes.
And who's helping lead worship with a guitar strung over his shoulder and helping lead some worship songs other than Alan Holzbog? So what a journey. Of course, you were talking earlier about a mutual friend we have, Pastor Doug Byram, who's a friend of mine. Now, unlike you, I didn't know Doug in the days when he was a drinker and partier. I only met him after he was a pastor.
Right.
And had quite an influence on my life and was significant in me returning to vocational ministry.
Amen.
But I learned through him that, yeah, Alan's getting involved in worship and on fire for the Lord. And I think, man, this story just keeps getting better.
Praise the Lord.
And then
all glory to God, man. It has nothing to do with me.
And then I hear that you joined company with Minister Paul Wallerzak and Bruce Hawkins at Hillview Christian. And I heard that you were participating in worship. And the next conversation I have with you, you're telling me that you're the worship minister at Hillview Christian.
That's a fact. And that it's unbelievable. I mean, I've been a drummer since I was 14 years old. Okay. And then 3 months after I was, the Lord saved me. Lisa had bought me a guitar for my birthday a couple of years prior to that. And for whatever reason, I remembered three chords that I was taught when I was about 17 years old. So I picked up that guitar and I just started strumming around on it. And of course, I didn't know what I was doing. So instead of trying to play a song or out of a hymnal or anything, I just started writing songs. All Christian, based lyrics. And none of them were really very good. I had a couple of them that I really liked. And in fact, there's the one that I use at worship at Hillview from time to time. It's kind of a snappy little tune, and we open the service with it from time to time. But
I didn't know that you played the guitar. Now, I remember I hung out at your house when we were kids, and you all had a guitar up at upstairs, either in the playroom or the boys' bedroom.
Yeah.
And I strung it around my shoulder and started strumming, and nobody, I think I remember your brother, nobody plays that thing. And your mom kind of laughed at me. I didn't have an idea what I was doing. I was just strumming. Your mom goes, "Oh, that sounds about like what Alan plays."
Yeah.
And I'm thinking,
at that time, that's correct.
Didn't know he ever played. So this is something you've picked up just more recently then.
Yes, just by trial and error. I mean, we've got all the information in the world at our fingertips anymore. So I admittedly have been on YouTube watching tutorials on certain things. And but as far as any kind of lessons, I'm self-taught. Again, the Lord's blessed me. And I'm just so thankful that He has brought me to a place now that it's not being the worship minister to me is not a job. It is a it's an honor. It's a lot of work, but it's a calling. And I can't imagine really doing anything else. I've tried to preach here and there at a few churches. I've been in the pulpit a couple handfuls of times, but my calling is in music just because of my musical background. And
so do you still drum any at all?
Oh, yeah. I do.
Do a little percussion now and then?
When our drummer's out and I can put enough people on stage to actually get behind the kit, I do. I play drums for the worship team, and I've got, out of necessity, I've learned to play both guitar and bass guitar. So when my bass player's out, and if I can get enough people on stage, I play the bass guitar as well. So kind of fill in where I'm needed, I guess.
It really about one of your biggest fans.
Who?
Kevin Brown.
Oh yeah. Yeah, she said to mention one of the biggest fans there that had given me a great deal of encouragement and really wanted us to, wanted me to be the drummer there when I first started there, was one of our classmates, Kevin Broughton.
Kevin, what an encourager Kevin is.
Yes, and
Doug Pearson.
And Doug Pearson at the time, of course, as well, but... Doug has since moved to First Capital in Corden, I think, is where he attends church now. I'm not 100% sure on that, but I think so. But Kevin and Tammy still attend Hillview, and it's really neat being there with our classmates, Kevin and Tammy, and then John Bowles,
right?
He won't come out and say it, but I think one of my biggest fans is Isaiah.
Oh, Isaiah.
Isaiah Bowles, yeah.
I get a text from Isaiah every now and then.
Every night. I do too.
Uncle
he's
Steve.
He's pretty excited about this interview.
He's extremely excited about this interview. I think he's
Isaiah
looking forward
is.
To,
oh,
to
man.
See it, hearing it.
Well, Alan, so. I just want to say that you said something that I wish more people that lead worship at churches really understood when you said it's a calling. I've met some really, really super talented people that lead worship, but it's not really worship because it's not their calling. There's a difference between being musically talented and being musically called.
Yes.
So I'm glad that you can distinguish that, you know, that you're called and that's what you're supposed to do.
Amen.
Maybe Steve and I can actually get away some weekend and come see you.
Oh, we would love that.
I did not know your story, and I've got to say, I work for, volunteer and teach at a drug rehab for women.
Mm-hmm.
And I will be, if I don't show them your video, I want you to know I'm going to encourage them. And we try to teach them all the time that relapse does not have to happen.
Amen.
That relapse is not just part of your story. That you can be saved, be delivered, be redeemed, and that be your story, that you not have to have a relapse part. So thank you. I didn't know that was part of your story, that from the time you got up from the altar, you no longer, you didn't have withdrawals. I know that when we are taking new clients into the drug rehab, we worry more about the people that are detoxing from alcohol than we do the people coming in from meth and heroin.
Amen.
And those things, because it is physically, usually, more dangerous. So your story is just a miracle in and of itself, that you didn't have any of those symptoms. And that just, what a testament to God's redeeming grace and power.
Amen. I wouldn't, I'm not going to say that's going to happen for everybody.
Right, right.
And by all means, use what's out there. If you need to see a doctor, go see a doctor.
Right.
If you need medication to get through the tough times while you're detoxing from the alcohol, by all means, go do it. But and like you said the word miracle, there are modern day miracles.
Yeah.
But it's not anything from our hands. It's all God.
Amen. What an amazing story you have, and I want to put this in a little bit a different perspective, because there's another significant highlight that I want to mention. But before I do,
You're not getting ready to play a harmonica. You saw me.
Sharon's panicking now because she thinks I'm going to go play a tune.
No! No, please don't.
We will have to jam together sometime.
Okay.
Oh, his harmonicas. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
What key are your harmonicas?
He's
in,
got
Steve?
One in every key, Alan.
Every key. Okay. Okay.
you just got to tell him what key you're in, and he'll grab his harp.
And my harmonica playing actually goes back to a connection with Hillview Christian.
Yep.
James Cool, he knew that I liked to play around with the harmonica, and he had a worship song that he wanted a harmonica for.
So that's James, who I have to blame for.
James is a phenomenal madness. Musician, but he doesn't know anything about harmonicas. So he goes, well, I'll buy you a harmonica. It's in the key of G. And at that time, I don't have a G harmonica. He said, I'll buy you one. So he goes out, he buys me a harmonica. We have practice. And I said, James, I can't. There's no way. This is just not going to work. I can't find it. And finally, we figured out that he had bought a G minor harp.
Oh boy!
So I was trying to play a major key in a minor harp. But through the process of trying to figure that out, once he got me on the right key and playing. And he goes, really, it sounds good. It's all right. Because I didn't have the confidence to really play. But he encouraged me, and he said, Steve, I'm not the best musician in the world, but I am an accredited musician. I would not want you on stage if it wasn't adding to the mix. So that gave me some confidence. But I want to go back to your story, just to put it in perspective. The night after you and I had that conversation, I was driving through the country, and I stopped in, had a conversation with your Uncle Lee.
Okay. And,
your Uncle Lee had not heard that you had gave your life to Jesus. So I got to tell him, and he had this look of not disbelief, but amazement on his face when I told
Praise
him.
Praise the Lord.
And he said, oh, man, that's the best news I've heard in a while. And I it kind of repeated to him. I said, yeah, he told me, Lee, I didn't know that he had an alcohol problem, but he told me that he was just a drunk, was about to lose his family. And Lee kind of kicked the gravel in his driveway. And this just shows some of the love that you have within your family.
Yeah.
He got this look on his face as he kind of kicked gravel, and he goes, well, Steve, I would have never said that about him myself, that he was just a drunk, but if he said it himself, I'd probably have to agree with it then. That's probably what he
was. Amen.
But anyhow, he was glad.
There was no arguing that point. No arguing that point.
But I remember that how encouraged he was to hear that part of the story. Now, one other thing that I want to mention, I'm scrolling through Facebook in more recent time, maybe within the past 2 or 3 years. Christine Harbison is a friend of mine on Facebook. And of course, Christine is the leader of the Crawford County, let me get it right, Community Foundation of Crawford County.
Yes.
Making generosity last forever. But Christine Post, getting ready to appoint a new board of directors, and who was chosen to serve on the Community Foundation of Crawford County Board of Directors other than my classmate, Alan Holzbog.
Yeah, that's...
I read that post and I started laughing with joy. And then I just asked a question. In 2014, of all of my classmates, you've named a few of them, but we went to school with a lot of people, and let's pick one next person from the class in 1981 who's going to be the least likely candidate to serve on the board of the Community Foundation of Crawford County than Steve Newkirk and Alan Holzbog.
Amen.
In 2014, Amen. My name will never be up for consideration. Not just because I live 300 miles away, but my credentials just start there. But what a testimony to your turnaround, that you went from a self-avowed drunk that was literally about to lose your wife, your wife that was absolutely madly in love with you, but getting ready to say, I can't fix him, to go from that to a relationship with Jesus, to leading worship, and then being recognized by the community to set on what's a pretty, I don't want to say prestigious, to make it more than what it is, but for all rights and purposes, it's kind of an honor and is somewhat of a prestigious road to be asked. So congratulations. Nobody's happier for your transformation than I am in that regard.
That foundation does a lot of good for the community. You know how poor this community is, and anything that the foundation can do to provide funds and grants for building this community up, I'm all for it. I'm still learning the ropes on certain things, but I've seen progress since I've been there. And again, nothing that I've done. Just it's a great board of directors. They're fantastic. A lot of smart people on there, smarter than I'll ever be. That really have they really have a love for this community and want to see it thrive. And there's things in the works. I'm encouraged by what's going on there. And so, it's not a plug for the Community Foundation. I'm just saying it does a good work for this community.
So let me, just for the sake of allegiance to my friends in Crawford County, he's talking about your Community Foundation of Crawford County, making generosity last forever.
Amen.
Okay, that's the promotion piece. Just a cheap,
okay.
Just a cheap little liner.
I want to go back just for a second. You were talking about my Uncle Lee when you stopped in and visited him, it's amazing how things turn through the years, and some of the things that you see happen that you never dreamed would happen. But my Uncle Lee and Aunt Naomi are actually attending Hillview at this time.
Wow.
And it is such a blessing to me to see them in our congregation every Sunday morning.
Set at worship with them. Wow.
It's wonderful. I'm just thrilled that they've made their way to Hillview, and they feel at home there. It's probably not the old hymns that they're used to.
But he says, Alan, I like that music.
But he likes that music. That's what he says, oh. Alan, I like that music.
Good.
Cool.
That's
good.
It's a blessing to have them there.
Lisa, are you still with us there? Sharon said she had a question for you.
I am. I'm sitting
down. Let me get out of her way.
I'll sit by Alan. That's okay. You can sit. I'll sit down here. I'll sit on the coffee table.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi, Sharon.
I just personally want to thank you for your friendship to me. We're not close friends. I'd say we're buddies. We didn't grow up
Absolutely.
Together. We haven't spent a lot of time together. We've never traveled together, mm-hmm. any of that. But you were always kind to me. Mm-hmm. And there were times when your kindness and your smile has been a real encouragement to me. And it was even before you were in church.
Right.
You were just always a kind person. I can remember talking to you at ball games and stuff, and I always walked away feeling lighter than when I spoke to you. And then Steve shared, I didn't know your story about your first husband and his death, mm-hmm. and you raising your girls, as a single mom for a while and stuff. And so I just want to say that there may be times when you feel like, oh, good grief, what have I got to offer? I want you to know you were offering positive things, making people feeling better mm-hmm. before you were even worried about it. So I thank you for that. I had a quick question. Alan said that he knew that you were in the throes of thinking, this, I can't do this anymore with this man, and that was why you'd went to church. My question is, what advice would you give to other women now that are maybe are there, that are maybe watching and their marriages are not what they think it should be, and they're just thinking, I can't go on, what am I going to do? What advice would you give them?
Well, with my job, I marry people. And one of the biggest things that I tell them all, marriage is not easy. It is not. And it's a commitment. And as I'm saying the vows to them, it's till death do us part, richer, poor, sickness, health, mm-hmm. And if you really, truly love that person, I chose to help him, and I knew that morning when I got up to go to church, Alan, like he said, he asked me, where are you going? And I said, my exact words were, I'm going to go seek serenity. I said, because I just don't know if I can do this. And that would be my advice. Don't give up. Pray about it. Seek serenity,
Did you grow up in church, Lisa?
Off and on. Okay. I kind of, when I became a teenager, it's not what I wanted to do. And I kind of just veered away from it.
Okay.
But through my adult life, periodically I would go here and there,
Okay.
But it wasn't something that I done regularly, no.
And so that morning you didn't have a church picked out. You just got in the car and...
I had no idea where I was going. I had my Bible, or a Bible, in my hand. I got in my vehicle and I drove.
Isn't that
something? I saw the steeple.
Mm-hmm.
And I pulled into the parking lot, and I sat in the parking lot because I still was not 100% that I was going to go in,
Right. Yeah.
And needless to say, I did go in, and I was welcomed with open arms. No questions, no nothing.
Had you been there before?
No.
Oh, wow.
And the pastor's wife took me by the hand and she said, come sit with me. So I did, and neither the pastor nor his wife asked me anything. She just sat with me. Wow. And as I was leaving church, they was in the back greeting people as they were leaving, and she looked at me and she said, can I pray with you? And I said, yes, please. So she prayed, I thanked her, she hugged me and whispered into my ear and said, don't do anything without calling me first, okay? Aww. And keep in mind, she knew nothing verbally. I did not tell her anything. I guess maybe my brokenness was showing through, because, I was going to leave the man that, we've talked about this so many times, as teenagers, at least twice this man asked me to marry him when we was in high school.
Really?
Yes, he did. And once it was after I had my first daughter.
Yeah.
I was a single mother, And he came to the house and he sat in my living room as I was changing her diaper. And he said, marry me, Lise. Aww. Marry me. We have a friend that drove him to my house that still to this day laughs and says that I beat him back to English with Alan before he left before me.
Yeah, she took me home.
I said, my life is a mess. I'm taking you home. 5:30, you know, we ran into each other periodically.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was just, hi, how you doing? You know, little conversation. But it was always so nice to see that face. There was always something there. Our lives were so, we look back at it now, and it was so intertwined that it's so hard to describe, you know. And I'm turning my head because I'm looking at him, and he's nodding yes.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that it was all God. I mean, everything. Not the fact that I lost my first husband or any, but it was just so, like he said, when I opened this box, and I had said to the man that gave me the number, no, I do not want that number. And I just wadded it up and put it into this box. And I was sitting there alone crying. And that number fell out of that box into my lap. And I thought, oh, I just need a friend. I need somebody that knows me, knows Lisa before all of this. Like I said, I did. I called and I didn't even tell him who I was. I just said, hey. He said, Lise, are you okay? He knew my voice.
Yeah, yeah. Wow.
Wow, what a story.
That's really cool. Wow. So kind of like we talk about on the Emmaus Walk, you guys can see God's prevenient grace
in
your friendship and your relationship, even when you weren't looking for each other or looking to God.
Yes.
God had his hand on both of you so that for a time as this, when you were able to get back together, there was still
it
that
was
bond
all God there. Because like Alan said earlier, his life was a mess. You know, he was going through some real trying times and he was so broken, you know, and I didn't recognize that man, you know, I didn't see that man, that broken man. I saw Alan, you know, this guy that always made me laugh and, you know, I used to say my concert buddy, you know, we like to go to concerts together and music and, you know, and he was my buddy, you know, my friend. And that's what I tell him yet today. I'm like, you know, you're my husband, but first and foremost, I won't leave you. You're my friend. Mm. You're my best friend. And I couldn't bear to lose my friend, you know. Mm. And that's what I told him in standing in his trailer. I took him by the face and I said, I'm here. I'm going to help you. I'm not going to leave you. I'm going to help you. And that's when we were just talking, friends, just, you know, trying to heal each other. But I remember taking him by the face and I said, you know, you're my best friend. You're my rock. You are my foundation right now. You're making me laugh again, you know, and I'm going to help you. I'm not going to leave your side, you know, and that rang through my mind is, oh, I had my things packed and in the closet. They was all hid away for the following Tuesday that I was planned. I call it the escape day. You know? And he was aware of it, but instead, you know, God didn't want me. And it all just took out. It was all God, every bit of it, our entire story. When we were kids, you know,
I think it was,
it's all God,
written down then.
Yeah. Like he said, it was written down then, you know,
yeah,
we didn't know that then. It was just that, you know, I, at that time in high school, it was like, I didn't want to go. I had other plans. I wanted to be here and there, you know, and, it's not that he didn't pursue and try, because he did, you know, several times. But I would get so angry every time he'd get another girlfriend.
You didn't want him at the time, but nobody else needed him either, right?
No. I can remember one time he was carrying this girl's book, and one of my friends said, "Look at him over there." And I will never forget this day. He probably doesn't remember it. He doesn't remember a lot, but I walked over and knocked those books out of his hand. Oh. I said, "Why are you carrying her books?"
That's great. I know you don't want to talk a lot about what you're struggling with right now. I will honor that. I would just like to say that through your Facebook post, through the couple times I've seen you since then, I want to thank you for your courage. But more importantly, I want to thank you for being vulnerable with people, Miss Lisa. Letting the rest of us know that being a Christian doesn't mean putting on this facade and pretending that life here on earth is always like heaven. Because it's not. We're not in heaven. We're not in this.
We hurt.
We're not in the Garden of Eden atmosphere. And sometimes we just hurt. And I thank you for that. For being honest with us.
Well, I thank you too, you know, because it would come in waves, and I'd had something to say, you know, thinking I had others that were going through it too, you know, and we communicated and little posts here and there, you know, kind of seemed, I mean, when I done it, I think I was searching for conversation, you know. Somebody talked to me, you know, and I just, it was probably one of the hardest things I've ever went through in my life. And I've lost. I lost my first husband, you know, he had a heart attack and died right in front of me with his face in my hands, you know.
Wow.
My dad, you know, I held my dad's hand as he took his last breath. And, you know, my mom just recently, but my daughter, that was a tough one. I felt absolutely helpless, even though.
Well, when you post online and you show your vulnerability, it does two things. First of all, it reminds the rest of us who can tend to go into victim mode, which I can do that so well. It reminds me that the opposite of that and to get out of that is gratitude. So you encourage me to have gratitude, but you also remind me that I need to pray for you. You're not saying, "Oh, please pray for me." You're just sharing who you are, sharing a memory, sharing a hurt. And then I don't even have to reach out to you and have a conversation with you, but our spirits can be united by my prayer and by God, you know, and I can say, "Jesus, intercede for my friend today."
Amen.
So Facebook is used for so much crap. I want to thank you for standing as a Christian. And I mean, you post great things too, scriptures that inspire me and fun things and sometimes funny things, but you also use it to minister to people. And so I want to thank you for that and I'm not always very vulnerable. I'm not comfortable being vulnerable, but there's you and a couple of other my friends that have went through some struggles that have allowed themselves to be vulnerable. And it has allowed me to say, well, if Lisa can do it and I'm loving on her, then I can do it and somebody else will love on me and pray for me. So thank you for that.
That's so true.
You've been inspiring. Just because I'm sure that there's been anger, you've probably had some bitterness, you've probably had some questions, all of that's human and all of that's okay. But through it all, Lisa, you have shown your consistency to know that there is a joy that doesn't equal happiness.
Yeah, you know, and that is so true. It's like I was just saying to someone just the other day, I said, you know, when you're going through grief, the deeper that you love someone, the deeper that grief is.
Mm-hmm.
And they say there's these five stages of grief.
Yeah.
I've said to so many, there's way more than five.
Yeah.
There's way more than five. You can ask my, I mean, I've sought counseling from my pastor. I went to a therapist at my doctor's office, and I now have a second one, you know, and we, but every time I go, I call it, there's this light bulb that comes on. It's like an awakening, you know, and I couldn't do it without God. I have to lean in on him. Yes, there's been a lot of bitterness, you know, as to, Lord, why, you know, and just trying to get through, because losing a child, Sharon, is anyone that is ever, you know, for me, that was the most devastating, hardest thing I ever did in my life. I never felt so helpless as I did in that very moment, you know, when I'm when I'm there with my daughter. Okay. And as a mother, there's nothing I can do, nothing. But I looked up at Alan and he said, let's pray.
Oh.
So we prayed for my daughter. And as she was, I'm going to add this in. It's a tough one, but the one thing that I
share what
I have is I was able to ask her. I said, Tasha, do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior? And in a growl, low voice, she said, yes, Mom.
Oh, praise the Lord, Lisa. Praise the Lord.
You know, and I had that, why I thought of that. But I just, that was all, that was it. That was all I could do. That was all I could do to help my daughter, because I knew she was leaving this world.
Well,
and
that was the
I wanted
most powerful.
To make sure that I would see her again.
Amen.
Yeah, and we do have that promise.
Well, yes.
I don't want to labor it, because I don't, I want to respect your wishes, and I don't want you to share and anything you don't want to share. But I just wanted you to know that your testimony, your courage, even in these trying times, have helped many of us, not just myself, but I know others that you've helped. And so thank you for showing your weakness so that you can show God's strength.
Thank you, Sharon.
You're
yes.
welcome. You're welcome.
Amen.
And I appreciate, once again, I appreciate your friendship. I love that you always make me laugh. It's probably a good thing we don't hang out together a whole lot. We might end up in trouble.
Well, you know what? There was a time I would have said, bring it.
But, I just want you to know you're loved, and so respected. And, I just want you guys to know that this guy, has been so touched by your love story, by your faith story. And he was so excited when he got a yes from you guys. Thank you so much for being willing to be vulnerable, and to be a part of what Steve's trying to do. You guys are amazing.
Well, I want to say to that Steve, I appreciate you for your willingness to first of all, ask Alan. I can't imagine, or I couldn't have imagined that I would ever be doing something like this. But, you know, your friendship over the years has been such an encouragement, knowing that if there had been a time that I could have reached out to you, it would not have been a problem for you. You would have welcomed it, and you've always been a friend. You've never cast me aside ever that I can remember. You've always been a friend. And I tell you what, the world is a hurting place when you don't have friends like you that you can lean on and talk to in times of trouble.
Mm. And our door is always open for you too.
Yep.
Oh, thank
always.
You. Thank you.
Well, Alan, Lisa, thanks so much for taking time. Let me share just a little bit about this effort. So many times, and of course, my story leans toward being involved in ministry for most of my life, whether I was in vocational ministry or not. But so many conversations I've had with people when they would just tell me how Jesus changed their life, and I would walk away And I have tried to retell those stories with groups and in private. Let me tell you about my friend Alan. Let me tell you about my friend Jake and Jalissa in Knoxville, mm-hmm. Tennessee, and the struggles that Jesus helped them with. But my inclination and my thinking is always the same. Boy, wouldn't it be great if somebody could have just been eavesdropping on that and could have heard that story from their own voice. So this effort is just to try to facilitate those conversations so that people can hear firsthand. In your daily walk, your conversations you have, people, they're impressed. Yeah, he knows Jesus, but you don't always have time to go in to tell your whole story in a personal manner. And so anyhow, that's what I'm trying to do. And thank you for being gullible and stepping up and sharing. To those that follow and want to encourage this effort, can't overstate the fact that people need to hear stories like this. Yes. And I have just over 1,000 friends on Facebook, but when I post a video, I have no control of who's going to see that or who's going to watch mm-hmm. it. But if you guys share it, if you're watching it, it spoke to you and you think of somebody in particular, maybe somebody we talked about, boy, they need to hear that. Steve and Alan were talking about, share it and tag them in it to raise the odds that maybe they will hear it. I appreciate that. So thank you for your support. And looking forward to future episodes and just sharing the story about how Jesus changed people's lives, because Jesus is the answer. Before we go, Alan and Lisa, off the top of your head, is there anybody you want to give a shout out to that just pops in your mind, somebody that's been particularly encouraging to you in your walk with Jesus?
Well, as you mentioned earlier, I would always have to give a shout out to Pastor Doug Byron. Doug's had his own struggles, and man, dearly, he is always going to be Pastor Doug to me, and so I would definitely like to give a shout out to him, and of course all the pastors that I work with now, Paul Wallerzak and Bruce Hawkins and Darren Stroud, our youth minister, they are encouragement. I mean, they just give encouragement like they're supposed to. I mean, they're Barnabas week in and week out, along with our elders. They're a great bunch of people, and I'm just so thankful to be part of Hillview Christian Church and all the good that they're doing in the community, because it's a great church and a God loving and congregation loving. They love God and they love people, and that's what it's all about.
Lisa, any name pop in your mind?
Yeah, well, you know, I was thinking, you know, Pastor Doug's wife, Glenna. You know, I always say to her, you know, because of you and Doug is why we are where we are now, because you loved on us when we were both so broken. And her reply is always, it wasn't us. And she points up, you know. And I do want to give a shout out to her, the congregation at Tunnel Hill, for loving us when, you know, we wasn't sure if we was even worthy to be loved on, you know. And then finding our second family as well at Hillview and all of our friends, that's been encouraging. And to all the new friends, you know, that we're going to meet along the way, you know. We love them, even the ones that we don't even know yet. We're praying for them.
Amen.
You know, they know who they are. And it's just you and Sharon.
Yeah.
You know, thank you. We love you guys. Mm-hmm. You know, we graduated high school together, Steve. So, that bond was set. You know, there's something about our graduating class of 81. I mean, we're family, you know, we are I mean, it's like everyone I run into, it's like, I just love them, you know? And, I think that the, God had his hand on us a long, long time ago. And I just want to thank everyone that's been there.
So I want to speak to that just for a second. As I stand here and I think, who would I give a shout out to? I want to shout out to the old saints that prayed for people like me and Lisa. Even when we didn't even know it. I think of my grandmother.
Mm-hmm.
How many tears that woman has shed prior to her passing. She lived to be 96 years old. Mm-hmm. And I've known godly women, but that woman was, I mean, she was the epitome of a godly woman.
You're talking about Miss Pauline?
Yes, yeah. Yes. And she, all those saints that prayed for us, and my mother shed many tears over my mess. She's failing in health a little bit now. So I'm thankful for that she never gave up. And, it took me 52 years. I was 52 years old when I gave my life to the Lord. And, that's a long time for a mother to be praying for a son.
Yeah.
But she never gave up.
Amen.
What a story. Well, thanks a lot, guys. We could talk a long time. I'm thinking back of the saints from Highfield Chapel Church, from Fairview Church.
Yes. Fairview Church.
A man that lived just down the road from me that I talked to Alan about, Gerald Carr.
And oh, yeah.
Gerald Carr's story was that he was a dysfunctional alcoholic for years and years. And he had a similar testimony to Alan's. Once he surrendered to the Lord healed him from that.
And
part of his testimony is he was so thankful because he said, God didn't owe that to me. And,
right.
And he,
absolutely.
He believed in his heart that if he would have had one drink of beer, he would have been hooked again. And he said, God may not miraculously deliver me twice. I may have to do it
Amen.
The hard way. Right. So he absolutely, that was his testimony.
Yeah.
But thank God for our heritage that we all share from that part of that rural community and extended to my Crawford County friends. A lot of good friends down there. Love you guys. And thanks for listening. We could talk all night, but with that, thanks for tuning in. And we will be in touch. God bless you.
Love you.
God bless you.
God bless.
Love you too, guys.
And for now, episode 5 of Steve's on the Mic with Friends Telling Their Story About Jesus is over and out.